Babe, by Robert W. Creamer. The book is subtitled The Legend Comes to Life. Dedication for Miggy Sheltz. Author's note. A certain flatness of perspective may be evident in some of the descriptions of Ruth's adventures, but I did not want to invent motive and detail when I could not be sure of the facts. I've tried to keep surmise, conjecture, and amateur psychoanalysis to a minimum. In a few instances, I have edited stilted dialogue from old accounts to make it sound the way it probably was spoken, but I have not imagined any conversations or thoughts. All derive from one source or another. Some of the baseball detail may prove tedious to the casual reader, who is given permission to skip such passages. Baseball fans are expected to wade through the whole thing. Robert W. Creamer. Part 1, 1894 to 1919. Chapter 1, Legend and Truth. Babe Ruth Lives. I apologize for not having talked to everybody. There were so many. Each week I would think, there, now, I've finished with that section. Now I know all there is to know about that. And a few days later I would learn of someone new, or someone I had not thought of, or someone I would never have thought of. And he would have one more window on the past for me to raise. A quick insight, an illuminating moment. Pete Appleton, for instance. The only thing I remembered about Pete Appleton was that his real name was Pete Jablonski, and I was wrong about that. It turned out to be Jablowski. I had to look up his record to learn that he had pitched in the major leagues off and on for 14 seasons. The clipping that came to my desk had Pete Appleton telling of Ruth phoning down to a hotel lobby from his room, asking the switchboard to page any Yankee player who's around down there. Appleton, who was new to the ball club, took the call, and Ruth said, "Hey, Keed, how about coming up and playing some cards with me?" He was lonesome, Appleton explained. He could not come downstairs to the lobby because he'd be mobbed by people, especially women. This was 1933. Where was Claire? There was nothing in Appleton's little story about booze and broads and gluttony and raising hell, just an edgy, lonesome man in a hotel room. And, said Appleton, he had the prettiest swing of all. The prettiest. An odd but strikingly accurate word to describe what Ruth did so much better than anyone else. Have you ever seen that old film clip of Ruth taking batting practice? If you like baseball, you remember the pretty things about the game. The individual moments of craftsmanship and, sometimes, artistry within the mathematical precision of three strikes, three outs, four balls, four bases, nine innings, nine men. Ruth, easing along at three-quarter speed in batting practice, stepping into the pitch, flicking the bat around, meeting the ball cleanly, cocking the bat back for the next pitch, is for me, and maybe Pete Appleton, the epitome of baseball, its ideal expression. This book had its genesis, I suppose, in my memory, because I saw Ruth when I was a boy. I saw him hit home runs in Yankee Stadium, and I remember that they all seemed to be 100 feet high in the air as they passed first base. I remember watching him swing and miss, his huge torso twisting violently so that he ended up with his face more than 180 degrees around from the plate, staring intently up into the stands, right at me. God, how I remember that feeling. Babe Ruth is looking right at me. I remember him in right field one day when a little dying quail hit began to fall into no man's land, that point of inaccessibility at the extreme range of center fielder, right fielder, and second baseman. And I can still see Ruth waddling in from right field and in as he tried to get to the ball. I think now that maybe the second baseman and the center fielder held up a little, giving way to the king. He had his right arm extended, the glove held low, and after his long, inept run, the ball glanced off the heel of his glove and fell safely. That was in 1933, too, when he was 39 and his fat was old. I learned later that those who had played with him in his prime hated it when people like me, who saw him only in those last years, recalled him like that. They remembered when he could run. He stole 50 bases his first four seasons with the Yankees, and field, and throw, and do everything on a ball field. Correspondence followed with Peter Schwed of Simon & Schuster, in the course of which it was decided that I would attempt a thorough, detailed biography of the babe. There had been several books written about him, all of them informative to varying degrees, but all necessarily limited in scope one way or the other. His autobiography, done with Bob Considine and Fred Lieb, was written when Ruth was desperately ill, at a time when it was difficult for him to speak and awkward for his collaborators to press him for nitpicking details and specific information.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.